Thanks for watching this video on my series of videos on college writing tips. My last video that I created was called Respect Yourself and Spell Check Yourself. I had to do that from memory, obviously, because I stumbled over the words. The next writing tip that I want to provide you is one that it really catches me by surprise. It's when the instructions say, give me four reasons why, you know, such and such happened. Or provide four of the five reasons why this war occurred. Or, you know, give me three of five reasons, you know, why such and such happened. And so I go through and I only find two, or I find one less than the number of reasons that I found. And I'm like, how did they, you know, when you go through and I use a highlighter or I underline the reasons, I'm like, I only find three reasons out of the four that I asked for. I only find four out of the five, or I only find, you know, two out of the five. Okay, well, maybe that's all they were able to remember. However, I teach a lot of online classes, and you know, even on my online classes, my online writing assignments, I get a lot of students that don't, you know, they'll give me two out of five or three out of five that I've asked for, and I don't understand that really. So, you know, usually in the textbook, you can go through and it'll have you, it'll say, you know, it may have a paragraph for each point. Or it'll say there were four different reasons why this particular faction did this, and so that makes a good essay question. Oh, discuss the four reasons why, you know, this group did this, and the students will give me two, and I don't really understand that. So you need to make sure when you go through and read the question that you actually kind of fulfill the requirements of the question. To me, like, these writing errors should never happen, particularly if it's an online class and you have resources there that you can go through and say, okay, one, two, three, four. I think part of it is, for a lot of the online classes, is that the students look at the first paragraph of a section in a book and they use that when that's only, like, usually when that paragraph may only be about the first reason, and they don't go past that. I see that cropping up a lot. Is the students will use the first paragraph in a chapter of a book, a subheading of a book, and they will say, "Oh, well, here they are." Well, okay, you need to keep reading because the other four answers or the other three are further on in the book. So you really have to scrutinize what's going on. Some writing errors should never happen. I know everybody can count past, you know, three, four, five, so I'm not really sure why they happen. I'm just kind of guessing. Usually you want to have a thesis statement. You know, you want to have an opening statement that sort of sets forth the argument that you're going to present in your response. Like, for example, in the creation of a good map, four elements must be considered. Okay, well, if you were going to talk about four elements, you better have four elements of cartography listed, not three. The author of the above sentence has set the stage for discussion of a good map by informing us there are a minimum of four essential elements that bind together a good map. The author needs to follow through and communicate what these four elements are. And the number of elements should also be apparent to the reader. I get really tired of first this, the second one is this, the third one is this, and then finally that. It doesn't necessarily have to be that way. That's sort of a clue as to weak writing, because you should be able to kind of merge these things in seamlessly without having to essentially enumerate them. And if you list them, you're going to get a zero in most classes, or you're going to get points taken off, because if a professor wants you to list something, they will say list. If they have to say describe or discuss, they're going to want prose. They're going to want sentences, full and complete sentences, not fragments. So again, go back and review some of the other videos where I talk about that. So proofreaders of textbooks miss these details as well. It's kind of crazy because I go through and scrutinize most of my textbooks pretty well. And every once in a while when I go through and scrutinize them, you know, the author will say, well, here's three reasons why this happened. And I'll only find two. I mean, because they'll go through and do something like, well, the first reason is this and the second reason is this. And then they move on to another topic. Like, you've just lost me. You know, the textbooks are pretty complicated. Sometimes they're written by 3, 4, or 5 people, so I can understand some of the details. But there's also proofreaders that exist to kind of count these things. And so, these things escape a lot of folks. Good textbook authors will open paragraphs with leading details, communicating in advance that we are about to receive some important information. So I'm going to read you a passage here. And there should be essentially 3 good plans. Let me take that back. I'm going to read you a passage and I'm going to comment on it here. Jerusalem is probably the most hotly contested city globally. Jews, Muslims, Greek Orthodox, and Armenian Christians all vie for access and responsibility. Due to the number of different factions with interests in controlling the city, especially the old city of Jerusalem, 3 plans are currently being evaluated to ensure all parties have fair and equal access to the world's holiest city. The first plan involves turning the management of the old city of Jerusalem over to a United Nations management group. While the composition of the management group has yet to be decided, the management of the old city by a disinterested third party could provide a potential solution. A plan suggested by a nonpartisan group of Christians and Muslims suggests the creation of a governing council comprised of a member of each of the 4 quarters of the old city. In essence, the old city of Jerusalem would be managed as a city within a city. Such a plan is not completely without precedent. Vatican City is an example of such a city. Each of the proposed plans has proponents and critics. Many people would prefer outside governance, such as the UN proposal. Other vocal groups rankle at the notion of having an outside group control the city, held to be the spiritual center of the world by 3 global religions. Time will tell whether any of the 3 proposals will be implemented, or perhaps a 4th proposal will win out. Okay, so this is a sort of a real life passage that I picked from a book. I edited it a little bit to make an example here. So we know in the opening paragraph, we're told 3 plans are being currently evaluated to ensure all parties have fair and equal access to the world's holiest city. The first plan is giving management over to a United Nations group. The second plan discussed was drawing members from each of the quarters of the old city of Jerusalem to form a management group. And then the summarization paragraph basically talked about, the different pros and cons of this and the potential for a 4th plan emerging. The problem is the author of this picked out, said there were going to be 3 plans. I only counted 2 plans. And then the summary paragraph potentially talked about there being 4 plans. And so this should have never made it to publication because there's some inconsistencies in the way that this document was written. So if you only counted 2 plans as I was reading it, you did a good job paying attention and listening, so I appreciate that. Poor proofing and editing by authors and publishers alike generate frustration among students and educators. I get frustrated when I see this stuff too because it makes it hard for me to, I've either got to figure out what the third argument was or essentially say there's only 2. So you've got to go through, and this is why teaching is kind of enjoyable, is because when you run across stuff like this, you're basically challenged by, okay, I've got to go research this, because if you don't have knowledge of this topic already, and if you've ever picked up a world geography book and read it, or got leaf through it, there's a lot of stuff in there. So not every geographer is going to have perfect knowledge about everything. That would be great, but it would also be kind of hard to do. But some of these areas are hard to find, and even professional writers kind of lose track of stuff once in a while. But how hard is it really to count 3 or 4 arguments? So to me, this should have never made it into publication. So in my next video, I will talk about making sure your arguments that you put forth in your writing assignments are consistent and congruent. Thank you for watching.